The caption for this morning meditation is, My feet on a rock. My feet on a rock. This message is going to be a great blessing to every one of you, probably in two different ways. It may not be directly applicable to all. For some of you, this message may be a direct application to make your feet stand on a rock. And for some of the others, parents, leaders, the elders, this message will help you help others, help your children, help your friends, your relatives. It will help you in your ministry, ministry among the youth, ministry among the children. It will help you. So in one way or the other, this message is going to be a great blessing to everybody. It will help you in your personal life, or it will help you in your pastoral, ministerial life. If you got a copy of the Bible, kindly turn with us to Psalm 40. And we shall read first three verses. Psalm 40 verse 1. I waited patiently for the Lord. I couldn't do nothing. I waited patiently for the Lord. And He inclined unto me and heard my cry. When I was waiting patiently, I was not keeping quiet. I was waiting patiently, but I was crying unto the Lord. Day and night, I was crying unto the Lord. Waiting patiently doesn't mean keeping quiet. Waiting patiently is continually praying unto the Lord. Hold on. Hold on. Continue to pray. Keep praying, keep praying, keep praying. When you are waiting patiently in the Lord, keep praying and He will hear your cry. I don't know when will He hear your cry, but I can tell you He will hear your cry. He brought me up also out of an horrible pit. So He heard my cry. It's not that He heard my cry. When He heard my cry, He acted. What did He do? He brought me up also. He brought me up also out of an horrible pit. Out of the miry clay, that horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock and established my goings. I don't know how many of you been in a miry clay. Anybody? Literally? So I had a small bad experience. Just in our school there was a pond. That pond is called Bethesda Pool. Bethesda Kulam. It belongs to our school. A lot of lotus and all. One day I tried to take something in, must be in standard 5 or 6. I just walked in, my feet caught in that clay, miry clay, cherry. So when I try to take one foot up, one leg up, the other goes down. When I try to take this leg up, the other leg goes down. By grace of God, I mean it will be a very shallow one. So my friends were able to just pull me out. Not a very deep pond, lake, it's a shallow pond. But I know what is that. So you are caught in a miry clay. The situation in a miry clay, every effort you take to come out, every effort you take to come out, will make you worse. You try to come out, things will turn bad. That is miry clay. Every effort you take to come out will make the situation worse. So here the psalmist says, the Lord brought me up out of a horrible pit. It's not only a horrible pit, it's a miry clay. Unless the Lord could bring me up out of that miry clay, it's not possible that I could come out on my own. When your feet are caught in a miry clay, whatever you may do, without an external help you cannot come out. Because every effort you take to come out will make you worse. You lift one leg, the other leg will go deeper. And you try to lift the other leg, this leg will go deeper. So only an external force can bring you up out of a miry clay. So here the psalmist says, the Lord brought me up out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay. Not only He brought me up out of the miry clay, He set my feet upon a rock, a place where I can sink no more, a place from where I can sink no more. Not only He set my feet upon a rock, He made my steps safe and secure, my goings. He made my going safe and secure. So in verse 3, and He had put a new song. It's another message. I don't want to get into it. He brought me up out of a miry clay. He established my feet, made me stand on a rock, and He put a new song in my mouth. What is that song? Even praise unto our God. Praise unto our God. And many shall see it and fear and shall trust in the Lord. He has got a ministry also. God willing, I speak on it later. My dear brother, my dear sister, so this is an experience of a psalmist, a man who was baptized, anointed, a man who had the Spirit of God upon him, a man who has written many hymns, many psalms, a man who has got the gift of prophecy. It was the experience of the psalmist that his feet were caught in a miry clay. My dear brother, my dear sister, in the name of Jesus I love to tell you, whosoever you and I may be born again, baptized, receive the Holy Spirit, gifts of prophecy, but in one way or the other, your feet may be caught in a miry clay. You may find yourself in a horrible pit. And every effort you take to come out of that horrible pit makes the situation worse. Many sins, many bad habits will take us into this horrible pit. There are a number of Bible passages. To save time, I don't want to read all those passages, but I just read one passage to you. There are many passages like that. 1 Corinthians chapter 6. I shall read from verse 9. If you got a copy of the Bible, kindly turn with us to 1 Corinthians chapter 6. From verse 9. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Don't you know that? Don't you know that? Believer, young girl, young boy, brother, sister, don't you know? Don't you know this? The unrighteous, that is who is not doing things what is right with God. Those who are not doing things what is right with God. The unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God. Don't you know this? Know you not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived. Don't be deceived. Because you are born again, because you receive the Holy Spirit, because you are baptized, because you are going to a spiritual church, don't be deceived. Don't be deceived. Neither fornicators, idolaters, adulterers, effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall not inherit the kingdom of God. So who is this unrighteous? Maybe in this category, is not completely exhaustive, it's only comprehensive. You can add to this many more things in the list. As I said, it's not exhaustive. Fornicators. When Paul was saying fornicators, it's not what we understand as fornication. He was using the word pornos, pornography, porn movies, porn talk, porn chattings, anything to do with porn. Maybe some good people, they may not know what I say by porn. Porn is nothing but sexual immorality. Sexual immorality in any form, a picture, a movie, a chat, any form you are given into porn, in the name of Jesus I tell you, you shall not inherit the kingdom of God. If a person who is given to porn inherits the kingdom of God, the Bible is wrong. The Bible is wrong. The Bible is wrong. If the Bible is true, anybody interested in porn will not inherit the kingdom of God. You are in a miry clay. Your feet are caught in a horrible pit. Your feet are caught in a horrible pit. Anything to do with immoral sex. What is a moral sex and immoral sex? Sex within a marital relationship is a moral sex. Sex outside a marital relationship is an immoral sex. Reading a book on sex, is it within a marital relationship or extramarital relationship? Seeing a sex movie, a pornographic movie, or even a picture, if that could interest you, I tell you, you will not inherit the kingdom of God. So don't you know this, Paul says? Don't you know? Fornicators, that is sexual immorality. Paul was using the word pornos. From that only we get porn, pornography, pornos. They will not inherit the kingdom of God. Idolaters, adulterers. What is adulterer? Adulterers in the Bible, in a Bible dictionary you can see, extramarital relationship. Extramarital relationship. Relationship outside a marriage relationship. So in a general sense, whether married or not married, without marriage you've got a friendly relationship with somebody. A little plus friend plus. It is adultery. It is adultery. So the Bible says they will not inherit the kingdom of God, nor effeminate. If you don't know this word, I don't want to take time to explain this. In a very simple word, it can be the meaning is a beautiful, a handsome boy who is available for prostitution, effemination. Or to have prostitution because they are beautiful. One of the meanings of that word is selling. Somebody is willing to sell their body. And you've got a relationship, it's not just a friendly relationship. You love to have a relationship with somebody who is willing to share his body or her body. They're very soft for sex. You got a relationship with that person. Maybe in your thought. In a Christian sense, a little more than this, Jesus said, even if you got that in your thought, it's not only actual relationship. Even if you got that thought, effeminate, soft, soft targets, not abusers of themselves with mankind, man with man, women with women. Some people say that's right. Some countries have got law that says right, lesbianism or gayism, man with a man or women with a women. But my Bible says that's wrong. My Bible says that's wrong. Any boy, any girl, any man, any woman who is interested or who gets hooked to these type of immoral practices, he or she will not inherit the kingdom of God. Again I tell you, the Bible is true. I believe it. Otherwise the Bible should be wrong. They will not go to heaven. unless they change. God is merciful. And he continues the list, not thieves, those who rob others, those who rob others money, those who rob others things, those who rob others names, those who rob others fame. Thieves, in a stealthy way, you steal. Don't you know that they will not inherit the kingdom of God? There's no surprise. The kingdom of God is not for the thieves. And you can't rob God also. When you don't pay your tithe, or when you're not sincere in paying your tithe, you're robbing God, the Bible says. I don't know, it's a very big question for me. Will God allow the robbers to heaven? Will God allow the robbers to heaven? So thieves, not covetous. The literal meaning is, it's not only that purulas say, the literal meaning is not satisfied with what they have. Not satisfied with what they have. They get always a craving desire, I must have more, I must have more. They get 10,000 rupees, no, I must have more. They get 20,000 rupees, I must have more. They earn 1 lakh, I must have more. They are not satisfied with what they have. They are not satisfied with a home appliances, what they have, I must have more. I must have more. Interestingly, I read one small anecdote. A lady, anything new that she could see, she wanted her husband to buy. Anything new. Whether it's a home appliance or whatever it may be. One day she called her husband and said, please, please come, we must buy this, we must buy this. He was worried, I said, what's that, the Diwali season? What is that she is going to ask? He said, come, come, come. Avanga vittla irukku, namma vaangana, avanga vittla irukku, namma vaangana. He came out and see there was a big road mixing machine, the sand, stones, and the road mixing machine was there. Yeah, yeah, this is not something home appliance, it's the mixing machine to lay roads. Why do you want it? It's on the road. No, 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 you see, make sure that it is before our house. Why should it stand before her house? It should stand before our house. Yeah, our vitumna laniki, other nama vitumna laniki children. A craving desire to have more, that is covetousness. And drunkards. Drunkards, nor revilers, those who make fun of others, those who make fun of others, nor extortioners. Extortioners, it is not only that you stand on the street and rob somebody. Stealing and robbing is different. This is pudungirathu. Thupakiya kattiya pudungirathu. Kattiya kattiya pudungirathu. That is extortion. Stealing is robbing without the knowledge of the person. This is demanding. There are so many boys and some girls also. They are extortioners. They squeeze their parents and kudu and vangita. He won't go for work. And a drug cost one, and a bike cost one, and a phone van, and a dress van, ni vangi tanda da unde, illana saturva, illana kondruva, is an extortioner. Pudungirathu. Squeeze others and take it from them. Don't you know they will not inherit the kingdom of God? They will not inherit the kingdom. Don't you know this? And such were some of you. And such were some of you, some of us here, such were some of us in the past. You might have given to any one of these problems. And now you are sanctified, you are washed, you are sanctified, you are justified in the name of Lord Jesus and the Spirit of our God. Now you are washed, sanctified, justified by the Spirit of our God. Washed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Sanctified by the blood of Jesus Christ. And justified in the name of the Lord Jesus, by the Spirit of our God. You were in the past like this. Now he goes to something very important. All things are lightful unto me. Not all those things given in the list. They shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Even there are so many other things, it may be right. The lawful doesn't mean it's in the law. It may not be wrong. All things may not be wrong. All things are lawful unto me. May not be wrong unto me. But all things are not expedient. But all things are not right for me to do. Now this is the problem with the believers, with the boys here, girls here. With the boys here, with the girls here. It is not wrong. It is not wrong. Having a laptop is not wrong. Having a net connection is not wrong. Having a smartphone is not wrong. Is that wrong? Is it wrong? Having a bike, is it wrong? Apparently it is not wrong. Can anybody say having a bike is wrong? Having a bike, is it wrong? Having a smartphone, is it wrong? It's not wrong. It's not wrong. Working with women in an office, is it wrong? No, it's not wrong. Studying in a co-ed school, is it wrong? It's not wrong. Traveling in a bus with passengers of other sex, is that wrong? No, it's not wrong. Hello, listen carefully. All things are not wrong. All things may be right. There's nothing wrong in it. But all things are not expedient. All things are not expedient, honorable. May not be wrong, it doesn't mean it is right. It's not wrong, it doesn't mean it is right. This is where we have to be careful. So in the time past, fornicators, sexual immorality, adultery, etc., etc., etc. Now the problem for the believers, right, wrong. Many a time, this is a very big philosophical question. You're walking under the street light in a village. You're walking in the street light. After some time you find that you're standing in darkness. Can you say where the light stopped and where the darkness started? No. No, this is where problem starts. You think that you are walking in light. Pastor Sundaraya used to say, if you ask a question, what's wrong in it? Certainly there is something wrong in it. இதெல்லாம் என்ன தப்பு இருக்குன்னு நீ கேட்டாலே அதில் தப்பு இருக்குன்னு அர்த்தம். பல முறை ஐயா சொல்லுவாங்க, இதிலெல்லாம் என்ன தப்பு இருக்கு அப்படின்னு நீ கேட்டாலே அதில் தப்பு இருக்குன்னு அர்த்தம். அதில் தப்பு இருக்குன்னு அர்த்தம். இதெல்லாம் தப்பா அப்படின்னாலே அது தப்புன்னு அர்த்தம். This is where the believers, especially the young children, are caught. See, just give an example. Having a bike is not wrong. But what is the purpose of using that bike? Say in the bike, you're taking your brother, are you a family member? Okay, there's nothing wrong in it. Okay, you're taking a friend, one who studies with you, a boy taking another boy, is it wrong with you? Absolutely nothing wrong in it. You're giving a lift to a stranger, risk. It's risky. You're taking a girl in the bike. Can anybody say that you can keep cool in your garment without the garment is being burnt? Can anybody say? You can keep coal in your garment without garment being burnt? Can anybody say that without any sensual desire I can take a person of the opposite sex, a girl with me in the bike? If that is to happen, you must be a Nirvana Samyar. You must be a Nirvana Samyar. For that to happen, she must be a virtuous woman born out of blue. நீ முட்டுந்தரந்த முனிவனாக இருக்கணும், அவள் படிதாண்டாத பத்தினியாக இருக்கணும். இட்ஸ் இம்பாசிபிள் ஃபார் எனி நார்மல் ஹியூமன் பீயிங். ஃபார் எனி நார்மல் ஹியூமன் பீயிங் இட்ஸ் இம்பாசிபிள். இஸ் இட் ராங் டு ஹேவ் அ பைக்? இட்ஸ் நாட் ராங். இஸ் இட் கிவிங் எ பில்லியன் ரைட் டு சம்படி? இஸ் இட் ராங்? இட்ஸ் நாட் ராங். இட்ஸ் நாட் ராங். Step by step. You may not know where it is wrong, where it is not wrong. That's why he says, all things are not lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient. All things are lawful for me. It's not, all things, it may be right. There's nothing wrong in it. But I will not be brought under the power of any. Brought under the power of any. Some evil will take power over you. You will be brought under the power of some. Really, probably I'm lost for words to preach in English. English is not my mother tongue. But I'm afraid, how many of you can fully understand this in English also? Because English is not the mother tongue of many of us. So most of these evil things have got power. Power of darkness, andhakaratin vallamai, irulin vallamai, the power of Satan, the power of sin, the law of sin, it's in our body, in our Indian literature. It was brought out very beautifully well. There was a sage by name Vishwamitra. He wanted to be away from all sexual immorality. So he went to a forest, doing penance alone. There was no temptation. There's no evil that he could do, because there's no evil was present. When he was doing penance alone, and the Vishwamitra Thaniya Yaga Sanjayutrikambhote, I think there came on Ali. There came an Alli. When Alli came, he committed sin. That's natural. Even Vishwamitra can't be exempted. It's a very simple truth. Why have they given the story? It's for us to understand. We cannot control. Nobody can overcome by controlling our mind. Mind cannot be controlled. I can give you a number of illustrations how mind cannot be controlled. Similarly, young man, he wanted to do some prayer, some yagam. So he went to a forest, he was sitting there alone and praying. He didn't want anything to be disturbed. When he was praying there, he saw a young girl, a beautiful young girl, going for a dance practice with a lot of flowers and all. And he could not but help himself. His eyes were just going behind her. His eyes were just going behind her. He said, no, I am come here for prayer. I should not do it. So next day he tied his eyes very tightly. He tied his eyes very tightly. The time came. He heard that noise, jing, 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 the chalange she had at her feet. Oh, now she is going, she is going, she is going. His head turned towards the side she was going. The third day he decided, no, I should not do it. So he plugged his ears also not to hear the chalange sound. He was doing his prayer. She was passing by. The perfume of the flowers came. His head turned. They how you disturb my prayer, she disturb my prayer. Next day he decided, when she was passing by, I must even hold my breath also. The time, how long he could hold this, we say 5 minutes. So a minute before she could come, she would come the time. He started holding his, tied his eyes, plucked his ears, and he was holding his breath. I should not give up. 1 minute, he was counting. 8 o'clock. Oh, this is the time she would, you know, she would be passing by. She would be passing by. You can close your eyes. You can pluck your ears. You can even close your nose. But you cannot control your mind. This power. Power of sin. It is in our body. God willing, when I take the spirit, soul and body, I'll explain. Paul cries, what a wretched man I am. There is another law working in my body that brings me into subjection to the law of sin. என்னுடைய சரீரத்தில் வேறொரு பிரமாணம் கிரியை செய்கிறது. அது என்னை பாப பிரமாணத்துக்கு அடிமையாக்கிறது. What a wretched man I am. There is another law, another power, another principle working in my body. You are born again, you are baptized. But there is another power working in your body that will bring you into subjection to sin. But Paul says, but I will not be brought under the power of any. When will the power of darkness can bring you into slavery? The power of darkness is there. There is a law, a principle in your body that can take you to lust. That can take you to covetousness. I want more, I want more. Even a pastor may have that problem. He may not be satisfied with what he has. He wants more money. He wants more wealth, more comfort. So where will he be brought under the power of that sin? It may be right or wrong, but when will he be brought under the power of sin? That is what we call in psychology, the behavioral science, addiction. As the time permits, I love to talk to you about addiction. When you say addiction, addiction, many times we think that addiction to liquor or addiction to drugs. I'll explain to you what addiction is. Addiction is an unusually great interest in something. Unusually, not an usual interest. You've got an unusual interest in a boy. You've got an unusual interest in a girl. You've got an unusual interest in an object. You've got an unusual interest in an activity. An unusually great interest in something, or a need to do or have something. An unusual interest, I should do that. An unusual interest, I must have that. That is called addiction. I'll explain what's an addictive behavior. Addictive behavior is any activity, any substance, any object, or any behavior that has become the major focus of a person's life. That has become a major focus on a person's life. Listen carefully. To the exclusion of other activities, and that has begun to harm the individual or others. Now listen carefully. What is an addictive behavior? What is an addictive behavior that becomes the focus of that person? So religion, ministry has become the focus of me. I got a great interest in ministry than any other thing. I'm willing to lose anything and everything for that. We don't call that addiction. But that habit, that desire, if that begins to harm me and harm others, that is called an addictive behavior. It harms others physically. It harms others, harms me physically, mentally, or socially. We call that addictive behavior. So it is not only liquor. It is not only drugs. Any activity. So just to explain, addiction is a condition that results when a person ingests a substance, something like alcohol, cocaine, or nicotine, some drugs. He ingests some drugs. Please listen, or engages in any activity. Not only he ingests, only that we think addiction. Not only that, engages in some activity. What are the activities? Maybe something like gambling, sex, or something like that. He engages in that type of activities that can be pleasurable in the beginning, engaging in that activity, the chatting, the sending messages, that pictures may be pleasurable, but the continued use or act of which becomes compulsive. After some time it becomes compulsive. You cannot but do it. You can't be without doing it. It becomes compulsive. It becomes compulsive and interferes with ordinary life responsibilities. You are unable to study. You are unable to go to work. It interferes with your routine. You are unable to concentrate on your subjects. You are unable to do your business. It interferes with ordinary life responsibilities such as work, relationship. Because of that you could not have a normal relationship with your wife. Because of that you could not have a normal relationship with your parents. Because of that you cannot have a normal relationship with your children. It affects the relationship. Because of this you have to give up your good friends. So it affects your work, it affects your responsibility, and finally it ruins your health. It ruins your health. Users may not be aware that their behavior is out of control. In the beginning, those who are getting into addiction, they may not be aware that behavior is out of control. I can give up. It's only one smoke. It's only one chip. It's only one gulp. It's only one cup. I can give up. Anytime I want, I can give up. In the beginning, they may not know that it will go out of control and causing problems for themselves and others. In the beginning, they may not know. In the beginning, you may not know having a WhatsApp group is not wrong. Is it wrong? In our church, we float WhatsApp group. Is it wrong to be in a WhatsApp group? Is it wrong to be in social media? At one point of time, you may know that you are gone out of control. You are gone out of control. It can be sex. It can be some extramarital relationship. It can be small robbing. It may be squeezing others and getting money. You know, borrowing is an addiction. Borrowing is an addiction. Some people never hesitate to borrow. They ask anybody, could you put it in the hand? They borrow with anybody and everybody. In the beginning, they feel that they can return it. I can do it. Anything they get on EMI, immediately they'll buy. Any phone call, you got a pre-approved loan, immediately apply. If they got credit cards, immediately they'll buy to the limit. It is a sickness. It is a sickness. I got a few credit cards with me, and some time back some of our boys were cleaning my drawers. They found one credit card which I never been using. Somebody has sent it, I never even used it. And I have used credit cards, but till this day, the office, those are handling my account, they know, till this day I don't have any revolving credit. The full amount I'll settle in that month. There's no revolving credit. So some people, this is a sickness, this is an addiction. If anybody gives loan, they will take loan. Just a phone call, you are available for loan, immediately they go for loan. They'll not be ashamed to ask for loan. Borrow money, they will not be ashamed. My dear brother, my dear sister, there are some people, they are literally ashamed to ask somebody, give me some 10 rupees, give me some 100 rupees, I will return it, give me some 100 rupees. They will be ashamed to ask money. These all are some sickness, brother, sister. And at one point of time, that will have power over you. You may not be able to return it. So don't think that only liquor is addiction. Don't think only sex is addiction. For many of us today, the addiction is the phone. Social media is the addiction. You are unable to come out of it. As the time permits, very quickly I'm going to show you 7 levels of addiction. Yesterday when I was in the prayer, when our fasting prayer, was very much burden in my heart that I should talk to the people. What I know I must share with you. Today is not just a Bible class, it's also a bit of psychology. I'm showing it to you from what I have learned. A study on addiction, level 1, how it starts. As I said, taking somebody on the pillion, going for a mall with a friend, just going for a tea shop. Is it wrong? There's nothing wrong in it. Nothing wrong in it. But be careful. Number 1, you can make a note of it very quickly. It will start as a recreation, something refreshing, stress buster. Umba bore chide, chuma paathirunne. Adi or dam eduthutta, chinna relaxing aranchi. Umba tension aranchi. That's why I say I may not be able to reach in English, that's why I'm sharing with Tamil also. அப்படி அப்பா அது உட்காந்து அந்த ஃப்ரெண்டோட கொஞ்சம் பேசிட்டு இருந்தேன், எல்லாம் மறந்துட்டேங்க. காலெல்லாம் ரொம்ப ஈஸியாக இருந்துச்சு. ஐ ஜஸ்ட் யூஸ் இட் அஸ் அ ஸ்ட்ரெஸ் பெஸ்ட், ஜஸ்ட் கோயிங் வித் ஃப்ரெண்ட்ஸ், ஜஸ்ட் வாக்கிங் அரவுண்ட் த மால் வித் ஹிம், வாக்கிங் அரவுண்ட் இன் த மால் வித் ஹர், ஜஸ்ட் ஹேவிங் அ கப் ஆஃப் நத்திங். வி டூ எனி திங் ராங். வாட் கிட்டிங், வாட் இஸ் ராங் இன் இட்? பாஸ்ட் இஸ் ஆல்வேஸ் ஃபஸ்ட் சேம். எவ்ரி திங் இஸ் ஏஸ் ராங். What's wrong in it? Just having a cup of coffee with another woman in the mall, is that wrong? Just walking with her, is it wrong? Brothers, sisters, boys, girls, as I told you, it may not be applicable to anybody, but you all can learn this and you can share this in your ministry, when you are ministering to others. So this has got 2 types of application. One is a direct application for somebody who is in the miry clay, and also it will help those who are in the ministry to help others, and also boys and girls in the colleges. A social etiquette. When I was I don't have time to explain this, I have said this many a time. When I was 22 years old, my first appointment with St. George's, there was a social. My principal, my institution treasurer, board member, it's a social party, it's a birthday, they want me to drink, just to have a sip. At least to say cheers for the health of my principal with soda. Social etiquette, I was uncouth. A person who didn't know the etiquettes. Clumsy. But I wanted to stand for my conviction. I said no. I was 22 years old. Many a time your sin starts with etiquette. It was in the year 82 that Hep C was born. I saw Hep C in the hospital. Hepsi and the mother. I was to meet her mother superior in Church Park, Mount Road. I went there. And there is an Apna Punjab, a restaurant just opposite to Church Park. I don't know how many of you remember that. So I just wanted to have some coffee or something there. Two boys from Don Bosco, their uniforms, spoke that out. Three girls from Church Park, with their pinafores, the type of a short dress. Five of them were sitting on a round table. The time the parents would be thinking these boys and the girls are in the school. These two boys from Don Bosco, three girls from Church Park, they all were sitting around talking. And one of the boys with his khaki pants, he was keeping his leg like this on the lap of the girl Church Park, who was wearing pinafore that was above the knees. I was broke to tears. Then I cried, Lord, you have given me a girl child. She has to grow in this world. She has to grow in this world. Probably the Lord heard my tears, saw my tears, kept my girl. In everybody, every normal person, sin is in their body. Social etiquette. My girls have called me. They wanted to take me to that birthday party. If you can't say no to your social etiquette, that could violate your Christian principles. One day or the other it will overtake you. Level one. I go to level two. And I think that they are showing on the screen, level two. It is desiring the substance, feel good, pleasurable, just put it that way. Desiring the substance, feel good, pleasurable, and peer pressure. Then after that you love to take somebody in your bike. You love to go for a mall walk. You feel good. You love to take that smoke. You love to take that liquor. You love to take that tablet. It is pleasurable. And there is a peer pressure. Your classmates, your friends, your relatives, your colleagues, they give a pressure to do it. That is level two. Level three. Now the addiction starts. Craving for a type of a desire for that. A desire to read that. A desire for that WhatsApp message. When you get up, before you could read the Bible, you just want to see the phone, any messages come. My dear brother, my dear sister, all humility I tell you. To this age, a pastor, when I get up, there are days, then I pray, okay, just to see what is in the message. Even before you could pray, before you could read the Bible, a craving for that phone. A craving to get high, that high from that boy. A craving to get that smiley from that girl. A craving, a type of a desire. A desire, a feeling the need of it. You feel that you need it. Then only you can break your stress. Then only you can feel good. You feel the need of it. Fear of missing it. You got the fear that you should not miss it. A simple example. You are addicted to a particular series, a serial, to a movie serial. That movie serial will be at 7:30. 7:30 a relative come. Yo, yes, jabam vera pannu. And vera yen the sunny porudhu. Because you are hooked to that serial. You have got fear that you will miss it. Can you see? Can you see that? You love that auntie, no doubt about it. But you don't want that auntie to come that time because you want to see that serial. The same thing even for good things. You want to have a prayer, you don't want any interruption. But that is a positive thing. The same thing that is a negative thing. You want to do something at that particular time, and you become restless in its absence if you can't get it. Suppose there is a power failure at that time. అయ్యో ఏసప్ప వరకు డూయింగ్ బికాస్ యూఆర్ గెటింగ్ హుక్ టు ఇట్ యూ బికమ్ రెస్ట్లెస్ ఇన్ ది అబ్సెన్స్ ఆఫ్ ఇట్ దీస్ ఆర్ ద సిమ్టమ్స్ దట్ యూఆర్ గెటింగ్ హుక్ టు ఇట్ యూఆర్ బికమింగ్ రెస్ట్లెస్ ఇన్ ది అబ్సెన్స్ ఆఫ్ ఇట్ అండ్ స్లోలీ యూ విల్ బిగిన్ టు డెవలప్ విత్డ్రావల్ సిమ్టమ్స్ Slowly you will develop withdrawal symptoms. You will not be interested in your mother. You will not be interested in your father. You will not be interested in a family chat. You will not be interested with spending time with your family. In your studies there will be a declination. You won't be shining as you are shining before. It can be anything. It can be a private, it's not only a sex with opposite immoral relationship with an opposite sex, even can be abusing your own body. Slowly, 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 you'll develop withdrawal symptoms. And please listen, there will be time pressure. When that time comes at 6 o'clock, the Bible says, the book of Proverbs, that evening comes. I'm not going by that street. No, I will not go by, I am a child of God. No, I will not go by that. Is it wrong to go by the next street? I'll go only by the next street where she lives. Is it wrong? When I go by the next street, I want to come by this street. Is it wrong? If she lives in that street, should not I go by that street? Go by the street. Is it wrong? Going by the street where she lives, is it wrong? No. She comes there and says, hi. Is it wrong? She's a very religious woman. You know from where she was coming? She was coming from the church. You know what she says? Na ipona samadhana bali ellam selithitan bali selithra pombalanga va bali selithra pombala. She's coming from the church. She comes that way. She tells him, is it wrong? Just giving an information. Is it wrong? Just telling him. Message. I am alone. I am going to sleep. I changed my dress. Hello, good night. Enna thappa? Sweet dreams. Yaar varanum dreamla? Na dreamla yaar varanum? Sweet dreams. Thappa? Idhula enna thappu irukku? Hello? Addiction level. You find some pleasure in doing it? Level 4. Compulsive. Frequency increases, seeing the phone increases, going to the place increases, doing the wrong thing increases, and dependability, you depend on that, without that you can't do anything, that increase needs to consume more and more to get the same old feeling. To save time, let me go a little fast. It causes, level number 5, it causes behavioral changes. It develops overactive or underactive. You dress up very well. Extra dressing, extra makeup, it develops. You're excited to meet that person, excited to get that call. As soon as it rings, is it from him? Is it from her? Oh, my friend, who is calling me? Oh, excited. You're getting addicted. My dear brother, my dear sister, you and I have to be very careful about it. Compulsive frequency increases, dependability increases, needs to consume more and more to get the same feeling. Behavioral changes develop, overactive or underactive, negligence of responsibility, negligence of personal care. Number 6, now things go out of control. willing to do anything to get the substance or to do the activity, things one may not do under moral circumstances. You'll be willing to do something which you may not otherwise do it. People are willing to rob. People are willing to stab their parents. People are willing to run away with somebody whom they didn't know. People are willing to give their life into the hands of somebody whom they have never met. Facebook friendship, Instagram friendship. They're willing to rob because they want that substance. They start robbing their parents, robbing their wives, robbing their husbands, robbing others. They're willing to do anything and everything to get that what they will not do otherwise. My dear brother, my dear sister, I was afraid that I may finish it in half an hour just to read those 7 points. But now I am fighting against the time how I could finish it, but I don't want to wind up without telling this story. Many, many years back, I read this story. There was a reporter going by a village road. Under a tree, a girl, a very fair-looking girl, she was lying down and ants were moving on her body, totally smashed. This man could hear only two words, only one word, water, water. It was a very chaste English. She was not with the proper clothing and all, very poor looking, but a beautiful English, water, water. Immediately this reporter ran to the shop nearby, get water, and the shop owner said, ஏதோ ஒரு பொறுக்கி பண்ணுங்க, நான் ரெண்டு நாளாக கிடக்குதுங்க, உடம்பெல்லாம் வியாதிங்க, நான் தண்ணி தர மாட்டேன். Then on a charatta, a coconut shell, he brought that water to that girl. And that girl started selling. She is from Kerala and highly educated. Her father was a military officer, brought up in a very disciplined manner. When she was in the college, her friends were giving her some drugs, and slowly, slowly she was getting the drugs. And at one point of time, she started robbing her own father, and she was getting those drugs. At times she has robbed her friends, but at one point of time she was not getting that drug. Then she was to fulfill the lust of the boys who were selling the drugs. And finally, she was to give her body totally to get the drug. And from Kerala, she was taken to Mumbai. She was sold in the brothel. Even one day, some 10 or 15 people were using her only because she wanted to have that drug. And sickness came in her body. She became a crushed rose. Sickness all over the body. She was thrown out of the brothel. Nobody wants to lie with her. She was lying under a tree. She didn't want to go back to her parents in that crushed condition. Immediately the report is a real story, real instant. If that can happen to that girl, can anybody say it will not happen to any of the girls in our church? If that can happen to that girl, can anybody say it will not happen to our children? The boy left that girl there, ran to an asylum to get the people to take her to the home. I think it was connected with Mother Teresa. By the time the van reached there to remove her to the home, she died. She died. A situation will come, the level of addiction. You will be willing to do anything. You'll be willing to kill your mother. Something happened in Perambur. To run away with that person, she killed her own mother. In Perambur. At one level, you'll be willing to do anything for the sake of getting that, because you are hooked to it. That's only level 6. Out of control, willing to do anything to get the substance or to do the activity. It interferes with family, health, society, work, causing problems for themselves and others, mind blocks. Whatever the father says, whatever the mother says, whatever the wife says, husband says, whatever the pastor says, whatever the church says, you will not listen to it because you are already in a mind block. Already in a mind block. You're not willing to listen to your parents. You're not willing to listen to any reasonable person. Because you are suffering from a mind block. If you are here in an addicted level, even now you may not be willing to receive it because you are already in a mind block. And till that time you may not know it is wrong. What is wrong in it? I love a person, what is wrong in it? I love this for my health. This is my stress buster. This is the only one way I can have happiness. I'm not happy with my wife. I'm not happy with my children. I'm not happy with my family. I'm not happy with my job. I'm happy only with this liquor. Why do you want to stop it? The only one thing that gives me pleasure. Brother, sister, till level 6, you may not be able to understand what you are doing is wrong. What is wrong in this phone? What is wrong in chatting? What is wrong just going with friends? What is wrong in going to the party? You will not accept it. Level 7. Heavy withdrawal symptoms. You don't want to be with your family. You don't want to spend time with your children. Good friends, with the co-believers, slowly will withdraw from everybody. Totally ruined. Level 7, now the victim may want to give up, but not possible. That's a sickness. You want to give up that relationship, you want to give up that friend, you want to give up that, but you are unable to give up. With a lot of efforts I have studied this, to help others. I don't say you are a victim, but I love to teach you this that you may be able to help somebody who is a victim. Probably you are in level 1, level 2, level 5, level 6. I don't see anybody here level 7. Level 7, you want to come out of it, but you are unable to come out of it. I want to tell you the Bible instance of the man suffering with the legion of spirits, but I don't have time. I can show you all these spirit problems. All these are connected with the spirit problem. All these 7 levels were seen in that man. God willing, I'll speak to you about that in some other time. Even this evening I can speak on that. My dear brother, my dear sister, 1 Corinthians 15:33, I love to conclude with this. I'm fighting against time. 1 Corinthians 15:33, be not deceived. Evil communications corrupt good manners. Be not deceived. Evil companions, literally, evil companions, evil friendship will corrupt your good manners. You are a born again child of God. Your friendship with bad company, bad friends, that will corrupt your good behavior. When I was praying, when I was sitting at the feet of the Lord yesterday, when I was preparing, many verses the Lord gave me, many verses my eyes went through, but one verse repeatedly I was saying within me, please you can make a note of it, with this we are going to pray, Jeremiah 17:14. Heal me, O Lord, and I shall be healed. Save me, and I shall be saved. For thou art my praise. If you want to help somebody, teach them this prayer. Heal me, O Lord, I shall be healed. Deliver me, O Lord, and I shall be delivered, because you are my praise. You are a child of God. Even today, if the Lord has spoken to you with these words. When I was sitting there, I was taking down 7 points. How could we? The Lord gave me when I was sitting there. That's why a few seconds I was delayed to come to the podium. I was jotting down 7 points. God willing, I say this in the evening. I'll pray on it. But now we can have this prayer. Surely those people can be helped. This evening I continue with this. Please do come. Those at the live stream, please join us for this evening service. Please do come. Don't be satisfied. Believers here, don't be satisfied with the only one prayer I love to tell you. Pray unto them. Heal me, I'll be healed. As long as you say what is wrong in it, you cannot come out of it. What is wrong in it? What is wrong in it? What is wrong in it? Pasundaram used to say, then something is wrong in it. Look unto the Lord. Are your feet in a miry clay? Are you in a horrible pit? Only the Lord should help you. There's a beautiful message in it. He'll bring you up out of the miry clay. He'll make your feet stand on a flinty rock. He'll establish your goings. He'll put a new song in your mouth. People will hear it and fear the Lord. When you give testimony, when you sing a new song unto the Lord, people will hear it. This boy, this girl, can somebody come out of these problems? Please, again I tell you, addiction is not only liquor. Addiction can be sex. It's not sex with some other sex. It is sex abusing your own body can be an addiction. You're addicted. You want a time, you want an hour. You feel that satisfies you. What is wrong in it? It's natural. One day when your body is ruined, you want to do what is natural and you are unable to do it. You want somebody to help you out. You thought it was occasional. Today is the day of salvation. This is the time of God's grace. Turn unto Him. He will turn unto you. Cry unto Him, heal me, I'll be healed. If you set me out, I'll come out, O Lord. Again, I appeal to senior believers, take this as a message, a lesson that you could help others. Small, small things. As I said, even borrowing, that's an addiction. Have an aversion towards it. Have an aversion towards it. It's a very serious topic. A lot of people could pray for the church.